broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney, or Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the Live Garden Show broadcast that we talk about everything about plants. We talk, I like to say, from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. So if it's a tree, if it's a shrub, it's your grass, it's a vegetable, whatever you're growing, we talk about it. So if you haven't seen the show before, I'm a plant pathologist and a botanist. Certified arborist and agricultural pest control advisor. I've worked in plant maintenance and landscape maintenance for more than 40 years. And so my expertise is really the technical aspect of maintaining landscapes. A little bit of design knowledge, but not much, other than put the short plants in front and the tall plants in back. And of course, shade plants in the shade and full sun in the full sun, but that's technical actually. So anyway, today we're going to talk about how to prune your trees. It's an incredibly important subject in landscape maintenance. You see horrendous tree pruning commonly throughout Southern California. And I don't know about other states. I haven't seen it so much up in other states, but I'd imagine it happens there too. And all you have to do is drive down the street in any community in Southern California and you'll see butchered trees, trees that are badly, badly pruned because people don't know what they're doing. So. But to start the show, we actually like to have upcoming events that you can put on your calendar, get out and enjoy some of the wonderful weather. Today is just an absolutely picturesque day in Southern California. It's going to be in the low to mid 70s and just a perfect day to garden or go to one of the botanical gardens or a park and just enjoy being outdoors and maybe learn something about gardening along the way. So let's take a look at our upcoming events. I don't know how many we've got, but let's take a look at them. Our first one is a weekend walk at Descanso Gardens. They probably have this every weekend, of course. So give them a call at 818-949-4200. This is December 11th, 11 to 12. I believe this is probably free with admission. And you'll get a little bit of information about the various kinds of plant materials they have at Descanso. Just an absolutely stunning jewel of a botanical garden. And there's a handful of them in the San Gabriel Valley, and there's some down south too. So get out and enjoy Descanso Gardens. The camellias are starting to bloom there. They have a very, very large camellia forest. They've got a lot of winter flowers and they'll have a big spring display too. So great place to visit and put on your calendar. In addition to that, we have the Ranch Open House, the Huntington Garden. This will be December 10th from 10 to 1. And they actually have what you could describe as a kind of an experimental farm or a ranch. Where they're growing a lot of different edible plant materials from fruit trees to vegetables. And you can go see how they're growing their plant materials and ask them questions about what will do well in your garden. So give them a call at 626-405-2100 for more information about the Ranch Open House at the Huntington Gardens on December 10th. In addition to that, we have the free nature tour at the Fullerton Arboretum, another wonderful arboretum in Southern California. This will also be on December 10th from 10 to 11. So they've got a nice tour showing you all the plant materials in their garden, probably pointing out a lot of native plant materials that you might be interested in growing in your own garden if you're trying to get away from high water use plants and grow more naturally occurring plant materials or plant materials that are really appropriate for dry landscapes or drought tolerant landscapes. Give them a call at 657-278-3407 for more information on the free nature tour at the Fullerton Arboretum. In addition to that, we have the organic fruit and vegetable farming. This will be at the LA County Arboretum where I was yesterday teaching a class on tree ID. This is also on December 10th from 12 to 4. This will probably be a paid class. Give them a call at 626-821-4623 if you're interested in attending. and you'll be able to learn a little more about the basics of organic fruit and vegetable farming, alternative ways for pest control, or organically registered pesticides. We've talked about those quite a bit here on the show. And if you have a question about them, give us a call and we can talk about your specific pest problem and how to control it without broad-spectrum insecticides or broad-spectrum fungicides and when those are actually kind of necessary or appropriate. So in addition to that, we have... What else do we have? We have... Oh, that was our last one. So we're going to talk about pruning today, and I've got a handful of videos demonstrating various aspects of pruning trees. We're going to talk about pruning shade trees or large trees, and then we'll talk about pruning fruit trees, because that's really quite different. When you're pruning fruit trees, you're not really pruning specifically for the aesthetic appearance of the tree, although if you prune it correctly, it'll look nice. But we're talking about pruning to enhance yield, pruning to prevent diseases in your fruit trees. There's a lot of issues that come into play when you're talking about pruning fruit trees. But we might as well just get right into how to prune shade trees. One of the first questions you want to think of is, why prune a tree? Does a tree really need to be pruned? Well, generally, yes, trees need to be pruned. You need to train their growth. It's especially important when you plant a new tree that you prune it when you first plant it. And that kind of pruning you do with hand shear, not a chainsaw or a saw. When you first plant your tree, you need to train it so it does not develop structural faults. And we'll talk about those structural faults. But let's start right off with a couple of different aspects of tree pruning. Let me just go down the general guidelines for tree pruning. Prune to enhance the natural form of the tree. That is so, so important. Never remove more than 25% of the canopy in a single pruning. Avoid wounds over 2 inches. Never top a tree. Never severely prune a tree. Do not wound the trunk. Do not let someone climb your tree with spikes and poke the trunk full of holes. Every wound in the trunk is an opportunity for the trunk to be infected with a fungal pathogen that will rot the trunk. And it's gonna happen. Sometimes those wounds will callus over and you won't get the decay, but more often than not, when you poke the trunk full of holes, you fill it full of cankers and infection. So nothing is really more important than not wounding the trunk. And that just goes directly to topping, because if you top a tree, you're cutting a chunk of the trunk. That's the biggest wound you could put in a trunk. So let's take a look at some of the important aspects of tree pruning. Let's bring up our first picture. And this demonstrates the bark branch ridge. Bring this up full screen. And this is important because this part here, over on this side, this is all trunk wood. This is all trunk wood. The branch starts here, okay? So the old practice of flush cutting, where you cut the branch off like this, you're wounding the trunk. You're making a larger wound than necessary. And it's going to, you're going to get decay in here, and you're going to end up with a decay pocket. And it's going to get bigger and bigger, and then the wind's going to blow, and this is going to break and fall off. So how do you remove a branch? Well, you always prune outside the branch bark ridge, and here's that ridge right here. Okay, here's your dead branch, because you want a reason to remove a large branch like this. It's either broken in the wind, it's decayed, whatever reason you have to remove a large branch, it should be a very valid reason. And often this is just called a branch collar. And here's the ridge, but you know, this whole area here is trunk wood. So when you're gonna cut this off, you wanna your final cut's gonna be here. And I have some other photos that'll show you exactly how you do it, but what you do is the first cut, you make 3 cuts, 1 cut here, about halfway to a third to halfway into the branch. Your second cut is here. You start here and you cut here. As you're cutting, you get to about here, this is gonna hinge. It's gonna start to fall. And this is gonna start to rip, but it's gonna hit this cut and then it's gonna stop. After this is gone, you'll have a nub like this. So you made 1 cut, your second cut was here. Your third cut is the last cut, right here. And then you remove this part, and you haven't wounded the ridge. If you just go ahead and start cutting here, it will hinge. You'll get about a halfway to a third, or maybe a halfway to a little more than halfway, and this will hinge. It'll fall, and as it does, it will rip the bark like that. You'll have a giant wound starting here like that. It'll be a disaster. It happens all the time. So don't, when you remove a branch, be careful you don't rip the bark. Let's take a look at our next picture. This will show you on a liquid amber, which is the Latin name is Styracifluia Americana, the American sweet gum. Here is that ridge right there. If you wanted to remove this branch for some reason, if you had a valid reason to remove that branch, you undercut it here, you cut it there, and you make your last cut there. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is the same tree, actually. And you can see that it's had a number of branches removed in, you know, up and down the trunk. And what you see is that after that cut was made, the callus grew and sealed up the wound. And now you might still get decay. You know, trees, when they get old, are often have a hollow trunk and are filled with decay. Very common. But these were removed in the correct manner to not severely wound the trunk. You can actually see right here that there's a little, that ridge is still there. You want that ridge to remain. Let's take a look at our next picture and talk about the two kinds of cuts that you can make in a tree. You want to, when you're pruning trees, make mostly what we call thinning cuts. Thinning cuts are when you remove a branch at its point of origin. Here's a broken branch right there. It's removed at its point of origin. That's a thinning cut. Here's a branch that's kind of going down. It doesn't really, it's not part of the natural form of the tree. It disrupts the natural form of the tree. And so it's cut there. Those are thinning cuts where you're removing entire branches. So every blue branch you see in here is being removed at its point of origin. So this lower one right there is being cut here. Now I'll take a look at our next picture, and these are what we call heading cuts. A heading cut is when you cut a branch back to a side branch. Also, you know, another term for this is drop crotch pruning, where you prune back to a side branch. So this is up in the lines, the power lines, and you can't have that because it can arc and set the tree on fire. So you got to prune it down. You got to make the tree smaller. Now, so you can do this, but you really can't turn a 75-foot tree into a 25-foot tree. That's butchery. That's severe pruning. So if you really have a 75-foot tree growing up into power lines, what you really need to do is remove the tree and plant an appropriate tree for that spot. But say it's just it's a 30-foot tree and a 5-foot of it's getting up into the lines, and you just want to bring it down about 5 feet. And so you prune back to a side branch, and here's the side branch right here. And it should be one-third the size of the branch you're cutting. So if you're cutting a 3-inch branch, you want to cut back to a 1-inch branch, roughly. You know, it's not rocket science, you know, you're not measuring the branches. But you're going to cut it here and bring it out, and then here's another, well, this is a thinning cut, actually, because you're pruning that branch as its point of origin. But heading cuts are when you make branches shorter or you make trunks a little shorter. So let's take a look at our next picture, and remember this. This is really important to remember. The first response to pruning is rapid new growth. So here's a tree that's been topped. It's been cut here, 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 here. And what happens after you cut it? Well, you've got a trunk here, like this, and you've cut it right there. Here's the cut surface. And the buds, all in the bark, they're everywhere. There's dormant buds all through the bark. When you take the top off the tree, and you remove the central leader, then all these buds start to grow like this. They all break and grow, and they just grow like crazy. And that's what you see here in this cartoon here. And also here, this has been headed back. Now you're going to get growth all over the place, coming up all over the place on this tree. So a lot of the guidelines are to suppress that growth response. You know, you don't want to stimulate too much growth. So there's a couple problems here. With topping. Come on back to me and we'll talk about that. So So trees have what is called apical dominance. Apical dominance is that the top of the tree controls the growth of the entire tree. It's coordinated growth. The top, the very top branch or shoot, the tallest central leader, is giving off hormones that travel down the tree and suppress the buds in the bark that prevent them from growing. So when you whack it and you remove the central leader, the apical dominant leader, all the buds in the rest of the tree break and start to grow. So there's a bunch of problems with that. Think about a young tree, a sapling, that maybe have an inch trunk, and it's got a branch on it. And typically, what happens in the spring is the trunk grows a little. And in the summer, the branch grows a little. And it gets longer, and it gets a little bigger diameter. And the trunk grows, and then year after year, the trunk grows, the branch grows. The trunk grows, the branch grows. Now it's 5-10 years later, and you've got a 12-inch trunk and a branch that goes to the middle of the tree. It was there when that tree was a little whip. Now you've got, that branch isn't gonna move, by the way. When trees get taller, it's because the tip is growing. A branch that's on the trunk here, 4 feet off the ground, in 10 years, will still be 4 feet off the ground. It doesn't move up with the tree. So that's another important point to remember. So when you whack a tree and you cut it off and all those buds break and start growing, they grow very fast. They are competing with each other to be the apical leader, to be the central apical leader. They will typically grow 10, 15, 20 feet tall and not branch. If you come back a year or two later, maybe 100 of those broke, maybe 50, 100, it's gonna be different on different species, but a lot of them break and start to grow. And you come back years later and most of them have died out, but there's 4, 5, 6 that are all, have now gotten pretty big because they grow very fast. They get big trunks, they get to be 2, 3, 4 inch in diameter within just a year or two. And they're all just shooting up straight up. Now, that branch, that new growth is only attached on the edge of the trunk. You cut it off, it started growing, but it's only attached on the very edge. Those branches can, in the windstorm, they can just rip and tear the bark down the trunk. Plus, you wounded the trunk. You cut a big hole, you cut the top of the tree off, and now you're gonna get decay straight down the trunk. So you've got weak branch attachment, and you've got decay. Perfect recipe for a hazardous tree, for a tree that will drop branches and land on somebody's head or a car or on the plants growing below and smash your bushes. So you end up, when you top a tree, you immediately create a hazardous tree. If you prune a tree properly, you minimize the hazards from trees. All trees represent a level of hazard. They're big, if we're talking about big shade trees, 40 foot, 50 foot, up to 75 feet tall, that's a big tree. A 30-foot tree is a medium-sized tree. A 20-foot tree is a small tree. Small trees represent a very small hazard. But large trees are always hazardous because even if it's been pruned properly and it's safe and there's no decay and there's really no problems, a strong enough wind will blow it over. If you get a 100-mile-an-hour wind ripping through a valley, it's going to knock over trees, it's going to break off branches, and those might be perfectly okay trees and everything, but trees just can't, there's a limit to what they can resist. And so over the last, 2011, we had a windstorm in the San Gabriel Valley that knocked down thousands of trees. And in 97, we had another windstorm in the San Gabriel Valley, and at the time I was working at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, and overnight we lost 100 trees. And eucalyptus trees that were 50 feet tall snapped off like a toothpick at 20 feet in that wind. That wind was hurricane force, 80, 90 mile an hour winds coming down out of the San Gabriel Mountains and just trashed the entire San Gabriel Valley. So high wind events are important because that's when you're gonna get a tree to fall over or branches to break off and fall. So you gotta think about that. That new growth, when you top a tree, is going to rip off and fall. And it doesn't take 80 to 90 mile an hour winds. It's, a good 20 to 30 mile gust will rip those branches off. So you don't even really need a really high wind event. You just need stiff, strong winds. So Let's take a look at our next picture, which is number 7. And it, again, will kind of illustrate this new growth response when you whack the end off a branch. This is a jacaranda tree, and it's been cut right here. Now, it was probably only cut a year or two before I took this picture, but you can see the new growth. All broke and grew. They're going to grow really tall and not branch. And now you're going to get decay right here too. It'll just decay right down here. Now these are only attached right here on the edge. This can rip and fall off quite easily. So this is, you want to avoid this type of pruning. If you need to prune this, you prune back to a side branch one-third the size. You do drop crotch pruning. You prune back to a side branch one-third the size of the branch you're cutting. The point of that is to suppress this type of growth. You don't want that. You don't want all this multiple branches. This disrupts the natural form of the tree. So let's take a look at the next picture. This also shows a problem in a tree. This is called a narrow crotch. In fact, this is probably the narrowest crotch I've ever seen in my life. So when this was a little tiny branch, just starting out, it should have been cut off. And then you wouldn't have, narrow crotches are structural faults. So let's see if I've covered everything I wanted to cover in these first few pictures. Let's go on to our next picture and talk about heading and how you make, so let's assume that they have a valid reason for cutting off this trunk right here. Because normally this would be a very terrible thing to do to a tree if this is the main trunk, and it certainly appears to be. And then here's this big side branch. So what they tell you is you want to make your first cut is a little wedge cut here. Then you're going to make a cut here. And hopefully this isn't, you know, too tall. And this is going to fall. Or you might have it tied off so it's got rigged so it doesn't free fall. But then you're going to be left with this piece here. Now you're going to come in and you're going to make your final cut like that with a slight angle so it's not absolutely flat. But that's a big cut. So hopefully you have some really, really good reason to make that cut. But that's how you would do it, because if you just come in and start cutting here, it's going to do this and it's going to hinge and you're going to have a wound like that on the side of the tree. So let's take a look at our next picture, which is a cutting sequence, which I've already mentioned, but we'll repeat it. Your first cut is here, your second cut is here, your last cut is here. Otherwise, this will rip and tear the bark right down here. If you're cutting a small branch, and you can use your hand shears, or you can use loppers, or maybe a little handsaw. If you can hold, if it's a small branch, 1 inch, 2 inch branch, you can hold onto it with your hand and cut this off and then throw it on the ground. But be careful, do not let this rip and tear that bark. And this branch has been cut properly because the branch, the ridge is still there. Let's take a look at some horrible, horrible pruning practices. You've seen it, everyone's seen it. This is a Magnolia grandiflora. I'll bring that up because we're going to look at these. This is a Magnolia grandiflora. You wouldn't know it from looking at it. This is the worst possible thing you could do to a tree. This tree will now break growth all up and down the trunk. It'll have shoots coming up like crazy in the next 6 months or so after this horrible, horrible pruning. You know, if you want people to do this to your tree, I have a proposition. I'll work on your car with a baseball bat, and you can pay me to pound your car into a lump of steel, and it makes just as much sense. Let's take a look at our next picture. Again, this is a Magnolia grandiflora that's been butchered. Take a look at our next picture. This is the Texas umbrella tree. It's been butchered. I don't know if they're just planning on cutting this whole tree down or what, but look at the size of the pruning wounds. You know, those are 16-inch pruning wounds. Look at that, all these cuts. And for some reason, they decided to leave the rest of it. Maybe they're going to come back and whack the rest of it off later. But, you know, maybe I just came by and they were coming back later in the day and they're going to cut it off here, which at this point, that's all you can do to that tree. Well, let's take a look at our next picture. This is actually a Chinese elm that just got cut off here. And then it just started growing like crazy. Somebody actually paid someone to do this to their tree. So, one more picture, this is olive, and this has been severely pruned, and this is a disaster. They've taken 95% of the foliage out. What happens when you do this? Well, First off, remember this. Trees, the leaves are supposed to be in the sun, and the trunk and the branches are supposed to be in the shade. In the winter, when deciduous trees drop their leaves, the sun isn't that hot, and it doesn't hurt the bark. But when you expose the bark to full sun in the summer months, especially August, September, October, it will burn the bark. And that is going to devastate your tree. So this olive you see behind me, if this is done, say in May or June, and then July and August roll around, and it doesn't have time to grow more foliage in just a month or two, and the sun comes in, and on the tops of the branches, it just burns the bark. Now you've got a big wound there. That's going to get colonized by decay fungi, and you're going to have a canker. And it's going to happen on every branch that's exposed to the full sun. And, you know, just think about 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in August, September, in the San Gabriel Valley, the San Fernando Valley, out in the desert, out in Riverside, wherever you are, and it's 100 degrees, 105 degrees, even 110 degrees. We get that hot, not always, but, you know, usually at least once every summer. And that sun comes down and just fries that bark. And you'll see that sunburn on the tops of the branches. You'll see it on the south and west side of the trunk because there's no foliage. As the sun's setting in the afternoon, it comes in and burns the actual trunk itself. It's just a disaster. Now, some trees are very, very sensitive to sun on their bark, like avocado, extremely sensitive to sun on their bark. But in the middle of summer, in August, really all trees are going to be sensitive to sun on their bark. So let's see what we got next. More severe pruning. So let's run through some of these severe pruning pictures. Here you see these are coral trees that have been topped and severely pruned. Let's take a look at our next one. And this tree's dead. This tree was severely pruned. You can see all these cuts. And the other thing you can see is there's no little shoots that died. It never even grew again after this severe pruning. So this tree is 100% dead, and the next cut is right there. Let's take a look at our next one. This one demonstrates something else. Now, I mentioned that you prune to enhance the natural form. You avoid pruning cuts over 2 inches. You do not remove more than 25% of the green wood in a single pruning. You do not wound the trunk. Avoid heading cuts. Use mostly thinning cuts. If you follow that, you're pretty good. But this is a specific problem where all the foliage along this length of branch has been stripped off. They took it all off and they just leave a little clump. Let's look, this branch even shows it better. They come here, they've removed all the foliage and left a little clump here. This is called lion tailing. This is going to stimulate new growth that is not advantageous to the tree. What happens when you open this up? First off, if you do this right before the summer, the sun's gonna come in and burn the top of the branch. The other thing that happens absolutely is you're going to get shoots growing like this, all along the length of this branch. All these branches are going to grow these shoots straight up. Each one of these acts like a separate individual tree within the canopy. It does not respond to apical dominance. These are called water sprouts. It has to be differentiated between suckers. Suckers come up from the root system below the graft union, and if they're up in the tree, they look the same, they're just vertical shoots. But these are called water sprouts. When you're pruning trees, one of the first things you remove are water sprouts. They disrupt the natural form of the tree. They don't respond to apical dominance. They come up, they grow quickly, just like any, you know, they'll grow 20 feet without branching, and eventually they just have to be removed. Now, if you come back 10 or 20 years later, they could be half the canopy and you can't remove them. So now you're stuck with all these problems. So this is called lion tailing. If this takes off and grows really fast, it gets really heavy, and it can cause the branch to bow. And that'll expose it even more to the full sun. So you get bow branching, you get water sprouts, you get sunburn. So lion tailing is a bad pruning practice. And also you can see they've removed most of the foliage in that tree. Let's take a look at our next tree. And this is a Canary Island. I guess we don't have the overthinning photo. This is a eucalyptus tree, eucalyptus blue gum. It's just been topped right there. Look at this growth. Everywhere on the trunk, it's just growing like crazy. All those branches are just attached on the edge of the trunk. If you're gonna prune a tree like this, just cut it down. You know, now it's ruined. You're gonna get heart rot going right down the middle. That thing really drives me nuts. Going down the middle. and all these branches are going to take off and grow really, really tall and really, really fast. When you have growth directly on the trunk of a tree, it's called apocormic growth. It's a sign of stress in trees. It is desperately trying to grow some leaves to produce food. You took away its ability to produce food for itself. It is desperate to grow new leaves that will produce sugars that let the tree survive. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is a Canary Island pine. This is apocormic growth. That indicates stress. This tree is under stress, severe stress. And all this new growth is just barely attached to the tree. It easily rips and comes off. Let's go ahead and take a look at this next one. This is a liquid amber, and it's been topped. Oh, come on. It's been topped. And all the branches have been shortened. So this is severe pruning. This is over pruning and topping. It's really bad for the tree. Let's take a look at the next picture. And this is also a liquid amber that has not been topped, but it does need some work. It needs a little pruning. You can look at it and see where it needs pruning. First off, when it came up, you can see it comes up like this, then it splits into two trunks. So it has co-dominant leaders. This one, of course, is a little taller. So what do we want to do here? Well, this is a pretty big cut to make right off the bat, but you do want to get up in here and probably bring this down a little bit. Bring this one down a little bit so this can be, darn it. So start over here. So that can be the central leader, and you're going to suppress the growth on that branch. So you're going to come down here to a side branch, maybe all the way to here, take that out and just leave it like that. That will slow the growth of that branch. You might also want to do that a little bit here. Just take this down to about here. You might come out here and take that one back. So you want to, not let these branches get, not let that start to compete with the central leader. But you don't want to come and be pruning these things like this. Come up here and just whack the whole thing all over the place. That's just not what you do. You might even, I wouldn't even cut the central leader at all. I would leave that alone completely. But I would shorten a lot of the others in order to let this become the central leader. And I wish that would stop happening. So anyway, so let's take a look at the next one. This is another liquid amber. These are some big trees, and you can see that's a structural fault right there. This is what you call a narrow crotch right there. So this should have been corrected when the tree was young and really small, but now it's very difficult to correct that. What you can do is take weight off of this branch by bringing this down a little bit, maybe to here. And then maybe this one up here, you bring down a little bit to here, and you maintain this one as the central leader. But, cutting that off there at this point, now you're going to end up with an asymmetrical tree. It's not going to be, most of the foliage is going to be on this side of the tree, and you got a big wound. So this is the kind of thing you get rid of when the tree is young, and you can do it with pruning shears. Okay, come on back to me. So, just to review, prune to enhance the natural form. Avoid any pruning wounds over 2 inches, and unless you have a compelling reason to be pruning large branches, like a 3 or 4 or 5, 6 inch branch. Why are you pruning off such a large branch? You better have a good reason. It might be blocking a stop sign on the street. It might be have a decay pocket in it. It might have broken in the wind. Those are valid reasons. So, natural form, 2 inches, avoiding over 2 inches. Never wound the trunk, only 25% of the greenwood in a single pruning. You remove all the dead wood you want, that is not part of the greenwood. And use mostly thinning cuts and avoid heading cuts, unless there's a valid reason to make a heading cut. So the question is, and then never let anyone use spikes to climb your tree. If you're cutting down a tree to the ground and removing it, sure, you can use spikes. But if you're going to want to keep your tree, more than another 5 to 10 years, then don't let someone climb it with spikes. So how do you climb a tree? Well, that's a good question. You climb trees with ropes and saddles, or if maybe you have a cherry picker. That's another good way to get up into the canopy and make these cuts without damaging the tree. So let's take a look at a little video here. This is Jack Richardson is going to show you how he climbs trees. You use a rope and a saddle. You get the rope up into the tree and over a large, sturdy branch, come back down to you, and you click it in, and so you have a loop, and then you have what's called a taut line hitch, which is a friction knot, which you can slide, and when you let go, the friction holds it. And let's take a look. He'll demonstrate this this tree climbing technique, which every good tree trimmer uses. You know, people who don't know what they're doing use spikes or free climb. Let's take a look at this video.
Hi, I'm Jack Richardson, owner of Guardian Tree Experts. We're a tree care company here in Ann Arbor. And this is my colleague, Chris Adler.
Hi.
So we're going to take a look at climbing a tree today. As arborists, we're forced to do this quite often. And so we're going to go through the process of how we get into a tree safely, move around in a tree, simulate working conditions, and then how we come down.
Yeah, maybe we'll just try this one.
Yeah, why don't I?
I'm happy to do that.
When removing trees, you know, people have seen the spikes on the feet, you know, that loggers wear, and when we take trees down, we wear spikes because it is easier to move around. When pruning trees that are going to stay in the landscape, spikes hurt the tree, so we can't climb with them. So we have to find another way to get into the tree. And that's what this is, this throw line. And I'm going to open this up here, take a look. But inside this cube is a weighted pouch that's about 12 ounces, and it's on a string. And we can throw this up to about 90 feet in the air. And basically we try to get it over a limb that's strong enough, drop it down to the ground, and then we can tie our climbing line on and pull that up, and that's what we'll ascend on, is our climbing line. It can be really frustrating. Some days you're on, other days it's getting hung up everywhere, so it's kind of a daily challenge, but we'll go ahead and try to set something up in this walnut here. You want to edit that one out. Heads up.
We have to look for hazards in the tree. Widowmakers, sometimes it'll be large limbs that are stuck up there. We don't want to climb up and get hit by something like that. Bees are another big issue. Raccoons and squirrels.
So what we're going to be climbing here is a walnut, a black walnut, and you know, some of the things we need to look for before we actually climb a tree is it safe to climb? Are there any defects, splits, or decay? I want to make sure we're not tied into any of those places. Isolated over a limb. We can clip our climbing line into it. This is, what is this?
Lava?
Anyways, 24 strand Kern mantle rope. So everything that we climb with in our system has to be rated over 5,000 pounds. And again, you know, I'm 185, so I'm never gonna really generate that much force. But so this line's rated about 5,400 pounds. All right. So we've installed our line, and it's away from the trunk, which means we can't use our bodies at all to get up, you know, walking up the trunk or anything like that. So in this particular situation, we're going to have to foot lock, and we'll go ahead and show you how that works. This can sometimes be the most difficult part of the day, is putting the saddle on without falling over. It's a very therapeutic thing to do, especially for me. When life gets kind of hectic and crazy, it's really nice to just disappear into a tree for a little while. climb around. You're so focused on what you're doing, before you know it, you know, your day is over.
So what he didn't show you was the knot that is used to connect your line to your saddle. So you throw the rope, get the rope up into the tree over a major scaffold, hopefully way up in the tree. Eventually you want it really at the top of the tree, and then you work your way down the tree. But it goes up and over, that comes down, and that clicks into your two D-rings, and then you have a tail, and that tail, about this long, wraps around the other side of the rope, and you wrap it twice down, you come up and twice up, and that's called a taut line hitch. You snug it up, and then you can move it, and then when you sit back, it cinches. And so it's called a friction knot. And when you saw him coming out of the tree, and he was just kind of descending, his hand was on the knot. And you pull on the knot, and you can come down. If he let go, he'll just stop. So that's how you, and there's different forms of the taut line hitch. There's one called a Blakely, where it's just a little different. And maybe people are using other kinds of knots now too. When I first climbed trees, everyone just used a taut line hitch. It was also called a monkey fist. And so that's the knot you use. Now, your clip is tied with a bowline. You know, you've got a little metal clip that clips into your saddle. Now, your saddle, the one problem with the saddles is if you turn upside down, you can actually fall out of it. And so in Europe, they don't allow the saddles we use in the United States. They have, you're tied in on the back, and you've got a chest straps, and you actually tie in the back. So they do it a little differently in Europe. We don't have that constraint. And I climbed trees and trimmed for 20 years and never had a problem turning upside down and never fell out of my saddle. And I've had a number of saddles over the years. Then the newer saddles are much easier to work with. The old saddles kind of were a little tight, and now they're kind of a little freer. I'd have to show you how they are arranged. But that saddle and your climbing rope allows you to move throughout the tree without spikes. And you want to tie in to the very top of the tree. It's because what you really want to do is get to the top of the tree, get your line in there at the very, as high up as you can. Then you start coming down, walking out on a limb, removing dead wood, removing water sprouts, removing crossing branches, removing branches that go from one side and end up on the other side of the tree. And of course, before you climb the tree, you can look at it and see, well, is it symmetrical or asymmetrical? If it's asymmetrical, you're going to try and take a little bit of growth off the side that's bigger than the other side, so you can end up with a symmetrical tree with even weight distribution. And always remembering, you can't remove you shouldn't remove more than about 25% of the greenwood. These are all estimates. And you can clearly see when you see a butchered tree that they've removed 80, 90, 95% of the greenwood. So let's just take a look at a couple more butchered trees. Let's take a look at number 25. Now, some trees are very, very tolerant of severe pruning, but if we bring up 25, this is actually a Chinese elm. And a lot of trees that are very, very resistant or tolerant of severe pruning, we actually hedge those and turn them into hedges. So you can actually turn a Chinese elm into a hedge instead of a tree. And this is kind of fun. If this is what you want to do with your tree, it's your tree, do whatever you want. This is obviously being sheared into a big ball, but it was at one point a real tree. And this is just the craziest thing you've ever seen in your life. Take a look at our next picture. Here's a Mexican fan palm that for some reason they decided to prune off all the growth here, leave this ring, and then here's your little bit of new growth. So that's pretty hilarious. I don't know who did that. Somebody pointed that and said, you got to go see this. So I ran out and got a picture of it. Now, I talked about when is the most important time to prune a tree, and my position, come on back to me, my position on when to prune a tree, the most important time to prune a tree is when you plant it. So come on back to me and we'll talk about that. So you go buy a new tree and you bring home your 5-gallon tree or your 15-gallon tree. And I like 5s and 15s. 24s are okay, but if you're going to plant a 24-inch box tree, you're going to need two guys to carry it around. Don't try and plant a 24 alone. They're too heavy. And then anything bigger than a 24-inch box, you know, the standard sizes are 1-gallon, 5-gallon, 15-gallon, 24-inch box, 36-inch box, 48-inch box, and then you can get bigger trees than that. But a 36-inch box tree requires a crane. It's going to weigh 500 pounds, maybe even 1,000 pounds. Well, even four or five guys can't pick up a 500-pound tree. Forget it. So a 24-inch box tree, especially if you let it dry out, I'll admit I've planted a couple 24s alone. But I let them dry out, and they weren't too heavy, and I got them in. But you know, boy, it's much easier with two or three guys helping you. But 15s are easy to plant, even alone. And fives are very easy to plant. And really, a 1 gallon will catch up to a five in a year or two. And a five will catch up to a 15 in a year or two. So I like to plant small trees. You get a better tree if you plant a smaller tree in the long term. When you grow trees in pots, you get problems with the roots, especially if nurseries aren't moving them up rapidly. So your tree, if they got a little 1 gallon tree and it may have a little elm in it or a sycamore or whatever it is, if you leave it in there too long, more than 6 months, the roots hit the edge of the pot and then start to grow in a circle. Then you take it out and you put it in a five. You leave it in there too long, it hits the edge of the pot and it grows in a circle. And you get circled roots. Circled roots are a big problem in trees. They really prevent the tree from getting well established in the soil. And actually can get bigger and bigger and bigger and girdle the tree and really damage it. So circled roots are bad for trees. They are very stressful. So nurseries need to move their stock up quickly. As soon as it roots out, as soon as the pot is full of roots, it needs to either be sold and planted in the landscape, or it needs to be moved up to a bigger pot size. So if you get bigger trees, you're more likely to have circled roots at the one, circled roots at the five, circled roots at the 15s. And so you got all these series of circled roots in the root ball. So the best tree you can get is by taking a seed and stick it in the ground and let it just grow all its roots in the ground. You will get the best tree by growing that way. I remember a long time ago, I was assisting the homeowners and the county public works department on Christmas Tree Lane in Altadena. And they told me that for years and years and years, when they would lose one of their deodars, now every Christmas, all the residents along, it's about a mile and a half long, all the individual residents put lights in their trees and their big deodars, they're 50 feet tall, 75 feet tall, and they fill these trees with Christmas lights and they have a lighting ceremony, and Supervisor Antonovich, that was his part of the county, would come and they have a big lighting ceremony and it's really beautiful, it's spectacular. But they're big old deodars, they're 75 to 100 years old, they've got armillaria root rot, they've got cavities underneath, so they lose one or two a year, and they got to replant them. Well, they always used 48-inch box trees. And you got to crane them in. You got to dig a big hole for a 48. You crane it in, you put it there, and those trees would just sit there, and they wouldn't grow very much. And then they decided to try sleeves, and they would get these 6x6 sleeves at the top, and it's about 2.5 feet tall, and it's got a little deodar in it that's maybe 3 or 4 feet tall. And you can dig the hole with a shovel, and one person can just slip it out and put it in and plant it, and you're done. And it costs you $25, maybe $50. I don't know what they paid for the plant. But if you plant a 48-inch box, it costs you $2,500 because the box tree itself is going to cost you $1,000 to $1,500, and then it's going to cost $1,000 to plant it. So it's very expensive. Well, what they found after they started using the sleeves, if the sleeves caught up and passed the 48s within a few years. Then they ended up with better, more vigorous trees when they planted smaller trees. Now, I know in parks and for street trees, if you plant a small tree, it's not going to survive. It gets broken over. And it's usually by teenagers or young boys, and they just vandalize these small trees in parks. So in parks, they always use a 24-inch box, and they often put up a little cage around it to protect it until it gets big enough that you can't just grab it and bend it and snap it off. You know, if you got a little 5 gallon tree, then it's only about 3 or 4 or 5 feet tall, 6 feet tall. You just grab it and snap it, and it'll just break off because it's only got the main trunk about an inch, 2 inches, and they're easily vandalized. And so in parks, they use big trees. On street trees, they use bigger trees. But they often put up stuff to protect those trunks temporarily. Now, so you've got your new tree. It's a 5 gallon or it's a 15 gallon, and you want to plant it. How do you dig the hole? Dig the hole no deeper than the root ball. So if the root ball is this big, your hole is that big. Don't dig a hole that's deeper. Set your plant in there. Realize it's 6 inches too low. Pull it out and throw dirt back in the hole, and then you set it in there. And then what's going to happen is the dirt you threw back in is going to settle, and that's going to drop, and you're going to end up with a root ball below grade. You do not want that root ball to be below grade. You want the root ball actually to be 1 inch above grade. So you dig a hole as deep as the root ball. You dig a wide hole, twice the size of the root ball in width. The bigger, more you break up the soil around where you plant the tree, the faster the roots will get established. And you, that first year, you want that tree to get established. The first year or two, you want establishment. It's not going to grow a lot of foliage. It's not going to take off, because that first year or two, it's going to mostly grow roots and try and get established. Once the roots really get in there and start growing into the soil, then the tree will take off and start to grow. So only as deep as the root ball, but twice as wide as the root ball. You set the tree in there, and now you got your tree. And you look at your tree, and you've got the trunk comes up. And typically in nursery production, what they've done is they've clipped the top of the tree. They've topped it with their hand shears. That causes the tree to break new growth lower down, and it looks like a bushier, thicker tree. That's not what you want in the landscape. That's, you know, they do it in nursery production, and they shouldn't. But it makes a better looking tree when you go to buy it. And of course, if you don't do that, they become long whips, but that's okay. The long whips are fine. But when you plant that tree, you do not want co-dominant leaders. So you've got this tree and it grows up like this, and then it splits into two or three trunks like this. So you're going to look at those three little co-dominant leaders, and you're going to pick one that you're going to keep. Usually the straightest one and the tallest one. The other two you're going to remove, but not immediately. What you do is you take off 1 to 2 inches off the tips of the others, and let the one that you want to keep, you don't prune that at all. Now what will happen is the ones you pruned, the ones you tipped, will grow slower than the one you didn't prune. And so the one you didn't prune takes off, becomes the dominant leader. A year later you come back and you remove entirely the ones that you tipped. So you end up with one nice dominant leader. Now you want your first scaffolds, your major branches, to start around 12 feet. You want your major scaffolds to be distributed radially and vertically on the trunk. You don't want them overlapping. You don't want two scaffolds starting on the same spot in the same space. You want one here, one over here, one, you know, you want them nice and symmetrically distributed and a nice, you know, you don't want all your trees to look identical, and they won't. But from a structural standpoint, you don't want co-dominant leaders. You don't want multiple branch attachment at the same point. So those are things you can fix with hand shears when you plant your tree. So you've picked those, you picked your dominant leader, you've tipped back the other ones so that they'll be dwarfed. You're going to come back in a year and remove them. What about the branches growing right on the trunk, 2 feet, 3 feet off the ground? Well, those branches eventually, like I said earlier, they're not going to move. That's where they're permanently attached to the tree. The tree, that branch, here's your trunk, here's your branch coming off right here. It doesn't do this. It doesn't, that branch, that tree gets taller, it doesn't do this. That branch doesn't lift up in the air and suddenly 5, 10 years later, it's 10 feet in the air. No, it's always going to be 2 feet off the ground or 3 feet off the ground. And that's too low, because typically in most landscapes, you want to be able to walk under your trees. So you want your first trunk, your first major scaffolds, to start at around 12 feet, 10 to 12 feet or so. But what about those branches on the trunk? Do you remove them immediately? The answer is no. You tip them, because you want those branches on the trunk that are, you know, eventually going to be removed entirely, but you want them there for the first year or two. They shade the trunk and protect it from full sun, because when you plant that little tiny new tree, the trunk is exposed to the full sun. So those branch side branches on the trunk will shade the trunk. Plus, they feed the trunk growth. That the food made in those branches is going to be used up, making the trunk get bigger and bigger and bigger. Caliper expansion. So you tip them. You just take an inch or two off the tip, and then you're going to come back in a year, year and a half, and now hopefully your tree has broken a lot of new growth on the central leader is taken off. You've grown a little bit of foliage. And now the tree is shading itself, and you can clip those branches off entirely. And you don't want to wound the trunk. You don't want to flush cut them. Prune them just outside the trunk a little bit, maybe a half an inch to an inch, and leave that collar alone. Now, eventually, that tree is going to get bigger and bigger and bigger, and you won't even see where that branch was attached once the tree is mature and has been in the ground for 10, 20, 30 years. So So that's the key. That's why I say the most important time to prune a tree is when you plant it, because you can eliminate future structural faults, which is codominant leaders or branches that are oversized, things like that. So now you also want to stake your tree. If a tree will hold itself up, it doesn't need to be staked. But typically, you've got the garden stake in the pot tied to the tree. So you don't want that stake up against the tree like this. You don't want a stake tied right up against it. That holds the tree really tight. And if you come back a year and you take the stake off, it still flops over like this. So what you do is you remove the garden stake, and the tree bends over because it can't hold itself up. It was being held up by that stake. Then you reach and you hold the tree, and you keep moving your hand up until the tree stands up straight. That's the point at which you're going to install your tree stakes. You take two stakes on opposite sides of the tree. You use a flexible material in a figure eight around the trunk that will keep the tree straight, but allow the tree to move a little bit. You don't tie it up tight like this, just tight. You have that flex. Some people use an old hose, and they kind of flexible, you know, and it goes around, but it allows the tree to move a little bit in the wind. When the wind blows and that tree just kind of rocks back and forth an inch or two, that actually causes the trunk to strengthen. And a year later, or a year and a half, you can come and remove those stakes entirely, because you only stake a tree for a year or two at the most. Staking injuries are common. If you leave that stake up against a tree and the tree's moving in the wind, and that stake is right here, it's abrading the bark. It's going to wound the trunk. The tape, that green plant tape that's wrapped around the trunk, will constrict the trunk and creates a permanent weakness in the trunk right there. I've seen trees that were left with their garden stakes for years, 5 years or longer. Now the trunk's this big, you got this little tiny garden stake. Obviously, the tree's holding up the stake at that point. But that green tape that was around the trunk constricted the growth of the trunk. And I saw a row of Canary Island pines in Pasadena, and they had all been had their stakes left on them, and they were in a row, and the wind kicked up one day and just snapped them all off, right where that green tape had been, right where that weakness in the trunk. Where does the trunk gonna break? At its weakest point. That weakest point is where you had that green tape that you never removed. So when you get your new plant, you remove all that tape, that green garden tape, and you remove that stake, you put it in the ground, you put in two stakes on opposite sides, you put in that figure eight soft material to hold the tree straight, roughly around 4 feet or 5 feet. It just, you know, like I said, you can hold the tree, and where it holds it up straight, that's approximately where you want to do it. I see a lot of times a second one put at the base of the tree. That is not necessary. That doesn't really help much. It's an old gardening practice that's really unnecessary. So we have a few minutes here. Let's take a look at staking. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is number 27. And this is about training young trees. Bring this up full screen. Now, the mistake they've made here is, now they've at least basically staked it right. There's two stakes on opposite sides. They have it tied off here, which is unnecessary. And they have it tied off here, and that's okay. But look at these branches coming here. This is a sidewalk here. This is a parkway. The street's over here. Okay? These branches are way too low on the tree. You want your first major scaffolds to be up here at 12 feet. Okay? So, what about these branches? Well, they're going to turn into major scaffolds. If you don't do anything to it, this branch is going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. You're going to come back in 10 years, and that's going to be a 6-inch branch. A foot off the ground, and no one's going to be able to walk underneath this tree. These branches should have been nipped. When this tree was planted, they should have just tipped it there and tipped it there and tipped this one and tipped that one. Then you come back and after a year or two, and you remove them here, and of course, when you tip them, it dwarfs them, and you get a smaller wound. If you let this grow and get to be big, now you're going to be cutting this off, and it's going to be a 2-inch wound or a 3-inch wound. You want to have a small wound right there and a small wound right there. So these shouldn't have been allowed to grow. That was a mistake. Because now they're bigger wounds and they're bigger branches. And all of these branches eventually have to go. They're all too low. What you do is you tip them when you plant the tree, and then you come back a year and a half and take them off completely. So take a look at our next one. which is this is okay staking. Like I said, this is not necessary. That one's really not needed, but this is okay. Now, you want this to be able to move back and forth a little bit. You don't want this tied up so tight. Now, one of the staking things I've been using lately is a steel rod that does this. And it's covered, and then it's got little things like this. And this has this is steel, and you put screws into the stake. And there's the stake, and you screw this in. And that actually, this was really nice. I installed five of these just recently on some pink trumpet trees where, you know, at our Southgate headquarters for the Ag Commissioner. And what's nice is that steel holds these, you know, hold these apart at that distance, and it works really well. But this is fine too. That's like a flexible material. You can use an old hose. You know, there's lots of things you can use for that staking material. You only want to stake for about 1 year. Well, come on back to me, and we'll get more into structural faults in a minute. But we always like to stop here at the top of the hour for station identification. I remind you that you're watching DHTV. A broadcast from Cal State University Dominguez Hills here in Carson. So let's have we'll take a little break here and kind of pump or give a good word for it's a great university. It's a beautiful campus, just excellent university to attend. All the Cal States really are, as are the UCs and the junior colleges. Like California, you know, what state in the United States has more colleges than California? None. This is the land of opportunity, California. Let's take a look at this station identification.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
We use zebrafish for our experiments because their DNA is actually very similar to humans' DNA. So it's a direct comparison and a direct use from our experiments with zebrafish to finding something later on to be helpful for humans.
It's important for undergrads to experience research because it teaches you way more than what you learn in a class.
I The purpose of our research is to study the interaction between the skin cells and the neuron cells and see how they're responsible for the sense of touch in the zebrafish. Eventually, we can relate it to humans and see when a person has lost their sense of touch to see if those neurons can regenerate and then, you know, give them back their sense of touch.
Undergraduate research is very important. The research gives students hands-on experience to help them understand the concepts they learned from the classroom. It's very exciting. You're generating something nobody has discovered before. This kind of engagement will really enhance the student's motivation of learning.
When you come into the lab, they're teaching us how the world works, you know, how it is going to be in research, in real life research, and gaining that experience.
This is the perfect timing for me to have enough research experience and then apply to graduate school. Really nice to have this opportunity here. My name is Jocelyn Yamamoto, and I'm a Toro.
It all comes back to this question, right? How do we define humanity?
One of the ultimate sets of values that the humanities program could bring to the future students is really lifelong learning tools that are just applicable in so many ways. I think what HUX 2.0 is doing is really going out of its way to celebrate, through a theme, through the cohort theme, a multidisciplinary approach to some of these questions.
What is the advantage of having a graduate program in the humanities? I think as an undergraduate, you're still getting your bearings, right? You're learning the basics of the disciplines. But in graduate study, you know, both of our anecdotes are about, you know, being able to kind of do more with that once you have the foundations.
You can think of these courses not so much as just the core that everybody has to go through, but instead think of it, this is the basis for you to expand, for you to explore the things that you find interesting. But you will have a connection with the other students so that you can have some sort of starting point for those conversations to continue.
Technology enables, you know, involvement through Skype and FaceTime and the idea of a symposium and having a physical presence on campus at the end of the program really ties things up very well, yet shouldn't scare anyone away because there's all sorts of potential for involvement through the technology. Being part of a cohort doesn't mean you're just sitting in front of your computer in your bedroom. You're actually part of a group, and that I think that's what the experience will be, is the cohort experience.
Benefits of this model involves the faculty because we can be closer to one another, and we're going through the cohort theme with the students, so there's a nice continuity for us.
The theme, thematic approach, and building through a fairly tight structure of courses towards a culmination in the symposium allows us to really program not just our own individual classes, but think together about how we're programming a course of study.
All kinds of career choices that future HUX students will choose, I think there's a well-roundedness that the humanities disciplines bring to that ongoing process that never seems quite finalized because it can't be.
Well, I think we are excited about this, and I hope you caught a little bit of our excitement. We hope you can join us if this is the kind of program that you find interesting, and we look forward to working with you this fall and on through the terms, the five terms of this program.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world, and I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And so we're back to talking about trees and tree pruning and, you know, everything about taking care of your trees in terms of planting them and pruning them, staking them, that kind of thing. So I have a publication here I want to show you. If we can go to the overhead, this is from the United States Department of Agriculture Forest Service. So let's go to the overhead and pick this up. And I'll show you this. You can find this on the internet quite easily. Just type in, USDA, you know, Forest Service, into Google or Bing or any search engine you choose, and type in USDA Forest Service pruning trees, and it'll be one of the first links. So here it is, the USDA Forest Service, how to prune trees. And this is really an excellent publication. And of course, the first thing it talks about is why you prune, you know, safety, health, aesthetics, why prune. But, you know, it's quite a few pages. Let's just flip a few and show you some of their... I've already showed you, actually some of the things I'm going to show you are out of this publication. So this talks about crown thinning, removing most of the cuts in here are going to be thinning cuts. I'm going to talk about this in a minute. This talks about crown raising, lifting the bottom of the skirt up so you know, have less. And this is a good point to point out that when you're done pruning a tree, you want... the top two-thirds of the tree to have foliage on it, and the bottom third can be the trunk. So it's one-third trunk and two-thirds, you know, foliage. And it points it out. It says here, 33% you pruned off down here, and then you left the top of the tree with, you know, 67%, or roughly two-thirds up here and a third down here. You don't want to have a tree with only the top half has foliage, because that makes it top-heavy. It can fall over. So you want to keep that one-third to two-third ratio of foliage to bare trunk. And then this is about pruning heading cuts to prune out of power lines. talks about pruning cuts, different kinds of pruning cuts. Again, this shows you what I've already shown you, you know, how to remove branches and the branch collar. So a lot of the cartoons I've already used on the show came from that. Here's, you know, this one that has been topped, and here's top, and this is, you know, here, this shows when you're cutting it, it can start to rip the branch down the way. If you make flush cuts, you end up with much larger wounds here and decay. And if you leave too big of a stub, then you're going to end up with, you know, shoots growing off that stub. So you don't want to have big stubs. You want to, you know, cut close to that. So anyway, this is really an excellent publication from the USDA Forest Service. You can find it on the internet quite easily. It really just will, you know, reinforce a lot of the things I'm saying today. And if you didn't get a chance to maybe take notes, then you just go get that publication, and it really tells you what to do. So we were talking about staking. Let's talk about narrow crotches and U-shaped crotches, because now we're going to get into a little bit more of structural faults that you can get rid of when you plant your tree with your hand shears. But if you wait 20, 30 years, then, well, you can't get rid of it. You're stuck with it. And then all you can do is try and minimize the damage, minimize the hazard. So I'll bring this up full screen, and we'll talk about crotches and narrow and U-shaped crotches. Bring this on up full screen. What you see here on the right is what we call a V-shaped narrow crotch. Here's your V, and this, often you'll see a line running down, which is called included bark. And this is more U-shaped. Now, generally speaking, you know, you really don't want this situation with co-dominant leaders, but you might be stuck with it. Maybe the central leader died out for some reason, and now you got these two. But if it's U-shaped, it's fairly safe. These are attached to each other right in here, and they typically don't rip and fall away. So that's okay. This is okay. Not great, but okay. Here you have a narrow crotch with included bark, and they are not attached to each other. Not attached. And this can rip and fall off. So this is a structural fault. That's not as bad a structural fault. So let's move on to our next picture, which will show you what we call bowl branching, where you have multiple branches attached at the same point. This is an old silver maple, which, by the way, are incredibly prone to decay. This large branch was cut off a long time ago, and it's got a decay pocket right there. This could actually mean about a good, you know, a big chunk of the trunk is decayed out. But up here, you see multiple branches all starting really at the same point. This is a structural fault. These branches can rip and fall off. They disrupt the natural form of the tree. You've got multiple co-dominant leaders. You can't fix this now. It's too late. You can't come in here and fix it. It's just, you know, and here you got another large branch that was removed with a decay pocket. So you got to fix this when you plant the tree by picking a central leader and dwarfing the other co-dominant leaders and then removing them a year or a year and a half later. So that's bowl branching. That's a structural fault. Let's take a look at our next picture. It shows more bowl branching. Again, you've got multiple branches arising at the same point right here. Not good. You want one central leader with your branches doing this and one coming back like that. You know, that's what you want. That's optimal. Let's take a look at our next picture. And this one is an oversized scaffold. Let's go ahead and take a look at this picture, number 32. This is a ficus microcarpa growing in Alhambra. And the trunk, I don't know, maybe that's, let's just say it's 3 feet. And so this is 3 feet. What's this? Probably maybe 2.5 feet. That's not good. You want this to be one-third the size of the trunk. So if this is 3 feet, you want this branch to be 1 foot. So what about this branch? Well, the shape is okay, the U is okay, it's not a narrow crotch, but this is just an oversized scaffold. It's too large, and it's too close to the ground. I said before, you want your first major scaffolds to be starting up here. Also, this has bowl branching up here. So when this tree was planted, it was just planted, and this had, it was a little about this big, like this. It had a little branch there. It, you know, got bigger and bigger, and this got bigger and bigger, and now you're stuck with this. You cut this off, you're going to probably remove half the foliage. So when you plant this tree, you don't let that happen. So this is a structural fault, an oversized scaffold. Okay, so I see we have a phone call. So let's go to our caller, And Sue, what our question is today. Who's our caller? Terry from Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yeah, I have a question about my plum tree. I have a Santa Rosa plum, and it's been in the ground for like 5 years, and I still haven't had any plums. I just don't know what I should do.
Well, Santa Rosa, you're in Pasadena, and Santa Rosa should do quite well in Pasadena normally, but we've had very, very warm winters. Now, stone fruits, which includes apricots, plums, nectarines, peaches, cherries, and almond too, by the way, all require what we call vernalization or chill during the winter months in order to go fully dormant and then blossom properly in the spring. So often when stone fruits don't produce a fruit, it's because we didn't get cold enough in the winter to really put them into dormancy. And so they'll bloom really nicely in the spring. So it could be that we just haven't been cold enough these last few winters. Or the other possibility is because we've got a disease called bacterial leaf scorch. And that disease is killing liquid ambers, olives, oleander, crepe myrtle, and plum. So if your tree's infected with scorch, that could also stop it from producing fruit, but it will kill your tree and there's no treatment. So there's not a lot you can do about that. If you've got a Santa Rosa, it is self-fruitful. So the other problem you can run into with all of these stone fruits is that they need another source of pollen, a pollinator. So typically like Satsuma is another very popular plum, but that requires a pollinator, and typically you grow Santa Rosa. Santa Rosa is self-fruitful, so you don't need a pollinator. So I would look at how often you're watering the tree. You should be deep watering it once a month in the spring and the fall and every 2 weeks in the summer. You want to fertilize 3 times a year, spring, summer, fall. And every winter, you want to prune it hard and remove about 2/3 of the wood. And we're going to go over how to prune stone fruits in a minute. But so it could just be our warm winters have not allowed your tree to go into full dormancy, or you could have scorch. Now, if you've got scorch, the edges of the leaves will turn brown. But then, of course, what happens is you get a lot of dead branches and then eventually the whole tree dies. So it's hard to say exactly why, but my bet is that we just haven't been cold enough these last few years. And that has been a general trend in all of California. A lot of the stone fruit growers up in the Central Valley are seeing big reductions in yield because of our warm winters. And this is due to climate change. We're just not getting as cold as we used to get. So hope for a cold winter. Hope for good dormancy for your fruit trees, and it should, hopefully it'll bloom up. Now, if it doesn't give you good bloom, after a while you might give up on it and go for something that, a non-plum, maybe go for, if you want to use really interesting fruit trees, pomegranate, I'm trying to think, Diospyros is the, I forget the common name.
How about persimmon? I was thinking
persimmon. Persimmon, exactly. Persimmons are fun. They don't require, as much chill. The pomegranates do really well. And so you might go for kind of an alternative or not a lot of people grow these other fruit trees where the stone fruits are very popular. Or you might even consider a low chill apple or a pear. A lot of the apples do quite well here. There's Beverly Hills and Anna and Gordon are all low chill apples. And then, of course, on the outside chance that maybe your tree was mislabeled, but probably not. The nurseries are pretty good about that. So if it doesn't start producing fruit for you within a year or two, I might give up on it and start with a new fruit tree. And remember, the fruit trees are short-lived trees, especially all the prunus. You can expect to get 15 years out of them, maybe 20, but by 15 years, their yield drops way off. And you usually don't get a lot of yield after that. And commercially, they're never grown past 15 years. Okay?
Oh, okay. Well, I learned a lot. Well, thank you so much.
Okay, you're welcome.
I'm enjoying your show.
Thank you for calling.
Okay.
Thank you for watching the show. So, anyways, if anybody else has a question about fruit trees or tree pruning, this is a great episode. But anything about your garden, give us a call. Don't be shy. We'd love to hear from you. So, we were just looking at that oversized scaffold. And I'm just looking at the time here. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is 33, which shows... a really narrow crotch. Bring this up. This is another ficus microcarpa. This is a narrow crotch. This is way too big. You know, basically this tree turns into two trunks. And so this is codominant leaders with a narrow crotch. This is very likely at some point in time to break off and leave a gaping wound here, which is really the end of the tree. This could have been fixed when the tree was planted, but it's way too late now. You could have fixed this with your hand shears. Now there is no fix. Take a look at our next picture, and because I want to show you what happens when it rips. You see this? This is a rip. This is a jacaranda. I took this picture. It's a county road, and the winds came up, really, really high winds, 50, 60 mile an hour. And this ripped off, and it left this gaping wound. It ripped like this and tore this huge branch off. Now you've got this open wound, and this callus will never come in and seal this. So this is going to decay. You're going to get decay down the middle of the tree. This is one of the worst wounds you can get on a tree. Looks like they tried to fix it right here after it ripped, but it was too late. And take a look at our next one. This also points out the dangers of codominant leaders. This was a California coast live oak up in Eaton Canyon. This is just an oak that grew all on its own. It wasn't planted. It's a naturally occurring tree. But when it grew, it developed two trunks. One trunk here and one trunk here that's gone now, because what happened was it ripped and fell and landed on the ground. It was half the tree. And you can see it also had heart rot. The middle of the tree was hollow. So often when trees get old, 100 years old, 7,500, 150 years old, they're going to be hollow. You're going to have heart rot. It's almost impossible to prevent it. But this was codominant leaders and probably a fairly narrow crotch. And so this fell and ripped away, and now the tree is badly, badly damaged. If this were in your garden now, I'd tell you to cut the rest of the tree down. Now, at Eaton Canyon Nature Center, they are loath to cut down a tree. So instead of cutting down the tree, because now this has a pretty good chance of falling this way. It's got a lot of decay. It's got a big decay pocket in it. So you can't have people walking under here, little children coming in to see the nature center. So what they did was they figured out how far it could fall, put rocks all around on the outside like this, planted a bunch of bushes in here so no one would walk under the tree. Now when this, it may land on some of the bushes, but it won't land on a person. And they'll just wait and let that fall over. In fact, the part that fell over, they left that too, let it rot, because it's all about educating the public on natural processes and native parks and natural parks. So that just shows you that. Now let's take a look at our next picture. This also shows what'll happen. I showed you this. This is from the USDA Forest Service How to Prune Tree publication. If you just start cutting here, it's going to fall and hinge. This is what we call hinging, because it just a little bit of this stays, and then you end up ripping the bark here, and you get that rip, and that's really bad. These are flush cuts. This is decay. You've cut too far. You cut it just flat against the trunk, and you have a bigger wound. They end up like an oval wound instead of a. You could have ended up with a wound like that instead of, you know, you should have had a wound like this, not like this, and then it rots. So that's a big problem. Let's take a look at some staking injuries. This is probably a melaleuca, a paper bark, and here's the stake, and here's the tree. What's holding up what? The tree is holding up the stake at this point. This should have been on here no more than 1 year. This wrap right here is constricting the growth of the trunk right here. This is now a permanent weakness in the trunk right there. High wind comes, it snaps off here and falls on the ground. So 1 year staking, 1.5 at the, or 2 at the maximum. Let's take a look at our next picture, more staking mistakes. People put in these stakes, they leave them there forever. Here are the two stakes. The tree is obviously holding up the stakes, but you look, you can even see how you've got these constrictions right here. And now all you need is a good wind and it'll snap and break off right here. So, or the whole thing will fall down. Let's kind of switch modes a little bit and talk about pruning fruit trees, and then we'll come back and see if we'll take a look at some more failed trees, because I have more pictures of trees that fell down, and you can go every winter and take about 1,000 of them if you want. But how do you prune fruit trees? And go back to, you know, our previous call, is you prune fruit trees really quite differently than you prune shade trees. Shade trees, we've talked about it, and enhance the natural form, 2-inch cuts or smaller, never wound the trunk, all that stuff, we've talked about it. You don't really prune stone fruits and apples and pears, deciduous fruit trees, that way. You prune them hard. You take out about 2/3 of the wood every time you prune them. You prune them every winter, every year. Why? Pruning stimulates new growth. New growth flowers more and produces more fruit. You're growing them for fruit, not necessarily to be aesthetic and pretty, and they can be. If you prune them right, they will be. They'll look nice. But you want to have that new wood that you stimulate every year with your pruning practices because you get more fruit. That's why you're growing the tree. So I have a really nice video from the University of Massachusetts on peach tree pruning. Now, there's two ways to prune these deciduous fruit trees. You can have an open center or a central leader. The open center is you take the central leader out and you develop four major scaffolds, and the middle of the tree is open to let the light in. And that's what you do for peaches, nectarines, apricots, cherries, things like that. Apples and pears, you use the central leader, where you maintain a central leader, one central leader, and you develop tiers of branches that, here's a layer, and you have a bunch of branches. Then you come up a foot, and you got another set of branches. You come up a foot, you get a third tier. So we'll take a look at this. Let's go to this video from the University of Massachusetts, the fruit tree advisor on easy peach pruning. This is about a 5-minute clip with a great little Beethoven soundtrack, and it really explains quite clearly how to prune peach trees. Let's take a look at this. I guess it'll be ready in a second, but there's a couple tricks you can do, especially for the central leader. When your pear or your apple is coming up and it's been in the ground a year or two, you often are going to have 3 or 4 codominant leaders coming up. You pinch those out in early spring. As soon as the new growth starts, you're going to pinch out those codominant leaders and pick one central leader. Okay, this video is ready. Let's take a look at easy peach pruning from the University of Massachusetts. Thank you. You saw there how much of the wood he really took out of that tree, about two-thirds of the wood. So remember, you select four major scaffolds, you simplify the scaffolds, you remove the small, pendant, weak, or upright shoots, and leave 50 to 75 finger-sized shoots on the tree. When you plant a new tree, a lot of times what you can do is just you plant the new peach and you just cut it off at about 3 or 4 feet. And then it'll break growth all below, and you're going to pick those four scaffolds. You don't want to end up with four major scaffolds. It really is your tree. You want to go with five major scaffolds? Go with five. But you really want to kind of follow these guidelines, and if you prune every winter, then your tree will produce more fruit, it'll be vigorous, and it should do quite well. The other thing you want to do when you're pruning in the winter months, especially on peaches and nectarines, is prune out any infected wood. Because there's a couple of important diseases. There's brown rot and shot hole, which are, stone fruit diseases. The fungi that cause those diseases can get into the wood and cause a canker. So if you see a branch that has an opening and it's infected, then that's really important to prune that out too during that process. It's gonna be one of the branches you're gonna target. So now let's take a look at a few more pictures. Now, let's take a look. I want to just show you a eucalyptus tree failure. Take a look at our next picture. This was at a park, LA City Park, number 39. And bring this up full size. This is an enormous blue gum. And I don't think this picture really does it justice, but I'm going to show you another picture in a minute. This just fell over one day with really very little to no wind. And so giant trees really are hazardous, because if this had landed on somebody, it would have killed them. Let's take a look at the next picture. There was a guy standing there in the park, and I asked him to stand next to this root. Look at the size of this root system that came up when this tree flopped over. This was an enormous tree, probably a good 100 feet tall with a 4-foot trunk, and it just flopped over, and I was actually asked to go and look at it to try and figure out why it fell over. But it's really hard to determine sometimes. There was some decay in the roots, and a lot of times it was what we call hidden decay. You couldn't see it at all. The roots were rotted. It could have been oak root rot fungus. It could have been Ganoderma. There's a number of fungi that'll do that. So you really have to very carefully think when you have these large, large trees, especially the big eucs, the big pines, Italian stone pines, blue gum eucalyptus, these giant, giant trees, whether it's time for them to come down, because the fate of every tree really is to either fall over on its own or be cut down at some point in trees. Trees don't live forever. They get to be 100 years old, 150 years old. They usually have a lot of problems by that time. Let's take a look at the next picture. This is also a eucalyptus tree that failed. And in this case, there were three main trunks. Now, that's Tom Nuzio there in the picture. This is at Nuzio's nursery up in Altadena. And this huge trunk flopped over from this big eucalyptus tree they were growing. And I don't think this is blue gum, but it's one of the big eucs. And what had really happened, take a look at this next picture. This was a triple-trunked eucalyptus, maybe even more. There's one trunk here, there's a trunk here, there's a trunk here, and there's a trunk here. You can see that it's got a hollow cavity here, and this is all decayed. You can see the fungal growth right here. It's all rotted. So from the outside, you couldn't see that. It was hidden. So it just, one day with no wind, this whole, really heavy. That trunk probably weighs multiple tons. Thousands and thousands of pounds, and this was just too weak at this point. This is the problem with bole branching. You've got multiple branches attached at the same point. What happens? Eventually, one of them fails and falls down, especially on some of these older trees that are prone to decay. Now I'll show you a rather interesting picture that was sent to me, and I've really never seen it before. He said he just heard this noise and looked out and saw that his tree had developed this huge crack that goes deep into the tree. Well, that's toast for this tree. Once a tree does something like this, you have to remove it, because the chances of it failing now are very, very high. And over time, this is just going to decay like crazy in here. This will never heal. So if you have some unusual pictures of trees, send them to me, because I love to see it. I don't have an explanation for why this happened, other than stress, structural stress, that the stress on the tree was greater than the strength of the wood, and it cracked and it broke. But that tells you that, something's really wrong here, and this tree has to be removed. So now we talked about, we just saw that little video clip on the peach trees. That's open center pruning. Let's take a look at this next diagram that shows you the process. So this is the newly planted a peach tree or nectarine, and you plant it and you just cut it off. Then it's going to, you know, it's going to grow a bunch of branches after you cut it there. They're all going to come like this. And then you're going to take out this one again, and you're going to pick, in this case, they just have three major scaffolds. It'd be better to, you know, have that fourth scaffold somewhere in there. But this is open center or vase pruning, very, very typical for all the stone fruits. Then there's central leader pruning. Let's take a look at the next picture. And this is really used mostly for pears and apples. And again, you don't want to whack out the center. You let the center grow. That's your new little sapling right here. And then it takes off. Now, on a lot of these apples and pears, they really tend to send shoots up that are very vertical, very upright. So what you do is you force these down so they become more horizontal. So you're going to end up with a tier of branches here, and here's your second tier. And eventually you'll have one, two, three tiers. And you can either use a spacer, a little piece of wood that you shove in here, and it forces the branch down a little bit to be more horizontal. Or you can actually tie a string onto the branch and tie that to a rock and set that on the ground and pull the branch down. Once that branch is at that angle for a year or so, it's just going to, it'll grow in that right there. So this is called central leader, and that's what you use mostly for pears and apples. You can also just turn your fruit tree into a fruit bush, and that's another way to do it. Let's take a look at the next picture. And this is the fruit bush concept, where you only let it get about 4 feet, 5 feet tall at the most, and you just turn it into kind of a bush. So I don't use this pruning, but come on back to me. One of the things you really want to remember is that you don't want your fruit trees to be 25 feet tall, because then it's very hard to pick the fruit. In commercial production, 10 to 15 feet tall is your range. I've seen some old orange groves with 25 foot trees. That just really raises their harvest cost tremendously, because now it just takes longer to pick the fruit. And then if you're hiring, you know, contractors to pick your fruit, they're going to look at that and say, we want more money. It takes, you know, don't pay us by the pound because it takes longer to pick a pound. So avocados, they keep them to 15 feet. Stone fruits, you're looking at around 12 feet. But a lot of people use that fruit bush because they don't want to even have a 12-foot bush. They want a 5 or 6-foot little tree. Then it's very easy to pick. So keep that in mind. Don't let your fruit trees get excessively tall. I went out to an avocado orchard many years ago in Malibu, and the trees were a good 30 feet tall. And in order to get up there and get the fruit, they had this huge ladder. They had to climb this 20-foot ladder, get into the tree, climb around the tree to pick the fruit. No, that's not what you want. So we have a little, a question coming in from Susan. And it says, I'm thinking about putting a greenhouse in my backyard. So let's see what else she has to ask. And let's see here. What are your suggestions? Well, I love greenhouses. I think they're fabulous, but keep this in mind. Greenhouses are high maintenance. I'd like to have a fairly large greenhouse, about maybe 12 by 22 feet. If you start with a small one, I think you might be disappointed later on that you didn't get a little bigger one. And you're going to need a couple things that are very important. You're going to need, depending on what you want to grow in your greenhouse. Now, typically you want to grow things that are tender, or maybe you want to, you know, grow things out of season. But I love greenhouses, but they are a lot of work. You're going to need to be able to cool it in the summer, because they get hotter than heck with that sun. It gets trapped in there. It'll be hotter than heck. So usually you use a swamp cooler. So you're going to need electricity to it, and you're going to need water source to it. Unless you just kind of maybe grow stuff, you can open it up in the summer months. Maybe you're just protecting stuff from getting rained on. Really think about what you're going to grow in your greenhouse, because that will really direct you to how you're going to design and what size greenhouse you're going to get. Greenhouses, you're either going to drape them with shade cloth, or you're going to paint them with a white, what's the correct term for it? White paint, but it's not really just white paint. It's more of a whitewash to reduce the amount of light getting in there to keep it cooler. So I would, personally, I prefer the shade cloth. I think that works a little better. But you generally, you don't just have it out in the full sun because it'll cook. So you want to cool it in the summer. You want to protect it from the full sun by draping shade cloth or painting it with whitewash. In the winter, you're going to need to warm it a little bit. So you're probably going to need a gas heater in there with a thermostat that's going to go on when if you get down into the 30s. And again, are you going to use your greenhouse to grow orchids? You'll need all the stuff I'm talking about. Tender tropical materials, then you're going to need all that stuff. How about if you're just growing some cactus and succulents and you just want to have them protected from the environment? Well, then you can just open up all the windows during the summer and you don't have to worry. It won't get that hot. And, close them up in the winter and it'll warm up a little bit, but you don't want to let it cook in there. Typically now they use polycarbonate for the actual, instead of glass. Glass is very expensive and so it's very heavy. So typically you don't use glass anymore. You use what's called polycarbonate. It's double walled and it really insulates. It's a very good insulator. And then you're going to need benches. You're going to need water source inside. Are you going to use a cement slab or are you going to have dirt inside? If a cement slab, you won't have weed problems inside because if you have just bare dirt floor, you could build your greenhouse on a perimeter foundation and have a dirt floor. But typically, you'll at least want a cement walkway down the middle because it'll be wet in there. You'll be watering and it'll be muddy and it's better to have a solid surface. If you use, what they use nowadays, the most popular benches are these pressed flat steel benches, and you don't get any moss or algae growth. If you're using a solid type bench, like a wooden bench, it gets wet all the time, it's warm and humid, you're going to get moss and algae growing all over it. And in the past, people would paint it with a copper sulfate to suppress all that growth, but if you use a flat steel pressed bench, those are really nice. You can also use plastic bench tops and you won't get a lot of algae growth. Now, and keep this in mind, you're going to probably have more pest problems inside a greenhouse than you do outside a greenhouse. In fact, not probably, you will, because it's perfect environment for the pests. It's great for your plants. It's also great for all those insect pests. So they don't get as cold at night, and that's really good for all those bugs. And there's no predators in there. Now you can open it up and try and get them to come in on their own, ladybug beetles and lacewings and pirate bugs. Or you can release them. You can get ladybugs in a little thing and open it up and hopefully you'll trap them in there and then they'll actually have to eat everything because one of the problems with ladybugs is they just all fly away. So keep in mind that it's higher maintenance, but they're wonderful. And my dream is to have a big, maybe 12 by 22 footer. But that would be good size. That's a good size one. And you're looking to get a kit and install it. Now, some communities, you might need a building permit actually to build that. In fact, almost all communities, cities will require a building permit for a large greenhouse. If you're not going to grow things that are tender and you don't really need a greenhouse, you might just go with a shade structure rather than a greenhouse. And I have a large shade house that I grow cymbidium orchids in and a lot of staghorn ferns and a whole bunch of other, a lot of stuff that I grow in there. But I don't need a heated greenhouse and an air-conditioned greenhouse. That is a lot of work. So anyway, I love greenhouses. There's a lot of people that manufacture them. Shop around, look on the internet, look at all the different manufacturers, decide what size you have. That'll really determine how much it's going to cost. Those bigger ones, I would say a 12 by 22 foot, you're looking at $2,000 or $3,000, probably just for the materials, and then you're going to have your construction cost. Somebody's going to have to build it unless you can build it yourself. And of course, you'll probably need an electrician to run your electricity. You'll need a plumber to run out the plumbing, especially if you're going to get a permit, because you'll have to have inspections, and they'll have to be done by licensed contractors. But it's great. I love them. I love greenhouses. I wish I had a real greenhouse, and currently I don't. I have a greenhouse window in my kitchen, almost the same thing. Well, let's see. We're running out of time. I do want to show you this next video. It's apple training techniques. Let's go and look at this video real quick, because this shows you how to train apple trees. Let's take a look at this video. Hopefully it's ready to go. Are we ready?
John Clements, welcome to the UMass Fruit Advisor. Today is Wednesday, May 31st on a warm, sunny day. We're out at the UMass Cold Spring Orchard in Belchertown looking at some trees that were planted last year. I have my colleague and friend, Wynn Cogill, from Rutgers Cooperative Extension with me today. Wynn is up here doing a sabbatical for the spring term with Wes Audio. And Wynn is going to talk about a couple of horticultural principles techniques to help train these young trees that are very useful on first and second leaf trees. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Wynn, and he's going to tell you about a technique called stripping, and we'll maybe do a little pinching. The whole goal is single out that central leader.
Thank you, John. Okay, we're going to talk today about a practice called stripping. And that is singling out the central leader so that we only have one central leader. Any young apple tree, these are two-year-old trees, get a variety of shoots. That first, second, third, fourth bud underneath the leader actually starts to grow. We get a bush at the top. So what we're going to do is we're going to single out that leader so we have just one shoot for our central leader, and we want to get that growing up 2 to 3 feet this season. So I'm going to actually strip these younger leaders off now, side shoots rather. Now that I've got one leader left that I left, that's going to really take off. All the energy is going to go up in that shoot, and I'll get 2 to 3 feet of growth on that. I might even take a few of these younger apples off right here if I wanted to do that. We want to get that leader growing up. Okay, we're looking at another two-year-old apple tree in the orchard. We've got 3 or 4 shoots growing straight up, and we want to single this out. We call this singling the leader. I want to get it down to one leader, one shoot that'll be my leader. So I'm going to pull these shoots out, take this cluster of really dominant side shoots out, and I might even take that guy out as well. Now I've got one single shoot that's going to be my leader, and we want that to grow 2 to 3 feet. And now that there's no competition, we might take this fruit off as well. That'll grow up and make a nice leader for us this season. Okay, this is a two-year-old tree that wasn't corrected last season. So what we have now actually is a two-leader tree, and we never want that. So what we want to do is leave the most dominant shoot to be the leader. So I'm going to come in here and make a cut and take that out. And now I've got one leader that's going to take off and be a very nice central leader for me. I actually may strip that out as well, so that now all my growth is here, and I'm going to get a nice 2 to 3 foot leader out of this tree this year.
Okay, Wynn talked about stripping. I'm going to just briefly talk about a technique called pinching, where particularly in a vertical axis tree, where we've got these short shoots coming out of the 1 year growth from last year, a recommended practice is to pinch these back. Take the terminal right out completely so that those will slow down and start to set up into a fruiting mode and set up fruit buds. So that's called pinching, different than stripping. And again, these are lower on the tree. They're not competing with the leader, but I do want them to be held back a little bit and not be growing up and out. This is just in the top of the tree, say about head height or above.
Okay, we've got our leader stripped out. And now we've got some competing side shoots that are growing up a little lower, but we want to save these for branches, so we want to train these. Ideally, we like to do these smaller shoots that are 6 inches or so. Here's one that's a little bit older, left from last year, and it's just a little woody, but we still have a good angle. So I've got these big blue clothespins, and we can just put it in there to get our angle right, and it rests right on the branch. And that works very well to get that little side shoot flattened out, and I'm going to do the one on the other side.
So what they were doing is training that tree to grow in the central leader fashion, where you're going to come up with a central leader, then you're going to have a tier of their first branches, and those branches tend to grow real vertical. So he was using those clothesline clips and to stick in there as a spacer and push that branch down. So this is how you're going to train your apples and pears when that's, you know, first, second, third year. And then you're going to do it, you're going to repeat it again. Once that leader gets taller, next season you're going to force the branches out horizontal. And you want the upper, you know, those horizontal branches, you don't want them right on top of each other, you want them spaced. Well, we're running out of time. We'll be back next season. This is our last show today. We're going to come back on Saturday next season, probably 12 to 2. I want to thank the crew for all their work all year helping put on the show. Thank everybody who's watched the show and called in. But we're done for this semester. We'll be back in probably the end of January. I want to wish you happy gardening. Get out, enjoy the weather. See you next spring, really. Oh, it'll still be winter, but we'll call it spring. See you in January.